Okay, sisters and brothers. It is my pleasure to introduce to you the next speaker. There are some days it seems like he's everywhere. At the legislature in the morning, calling on the provincial government to account for its plan to sell hydro. Outside on the lawn with thousands of education workers by lunch, rallying up the crowd against the Liberals' continued chaos and cuts in bargaining. Making other union leaders follow him and on the podium openly bemoan about the fact that they have to follow Fred Hahn. By afternoon, he's on the radio talking about the dangers of privatization and P3s. In the evening, he's in your community. He's at rallies outside our MPP offices or at a town hall meeting talking about cuts. Before you go to bed, you'll notice him on Facebook or on Twitter tweeting solidarity messages and pictures with our members. That's your QP Ontario president, our QP Ontario president, outspoken, tireless, principled, and passionate. Known all across the Ontario labor movement as the leader you want at your event to inspire our members to action, join me in welcoming our leader who is quickly becoming Kathleen Wynne's worst nightmare, my friend, Fred Hahn.
Thank you very much. I'm all for cuts. Thanks, everyone. Thanks. Thanks very much, and thanks for that kind introduction. I want you to now all lower your expectations because I'm about to give a speech. So, my friends, as your president, I want to have this opportunity to say welcome to our convention in 2015. And this section of the agenda is my report to you, but I want to talk about a theme that I have been thinking about all year, that I have been feeling in my bones. QP Ontario is living in history. Now, history doesn't feel like history when you're living it. It just feels like the daily struggle that we all live, the regular stuff we do as QP. But this year has been unique in so many ways. There's a saying that absolutely applies to us this year. Live every moment because every moment makes history. And I put it to you that our members, our locals, our sectors, our staff, all of QP in Ontario has been doing that this year. The activism of our union is making history. It started virtually right after the last convention because Tim Hudak was leading in the polls. He was supposed to be elected the premier. But we understood that if we were to be elected, our communities would be devastated. Our services would be damaged. Our union, our movement would come under direct attack. And so leaders left the convention. They went back to their communities. They worked harder than ever before to get our members out to vote. Now, in fairness, it wasn't all just us. I mean, let's be honest, Hudak kind of helped us out. His crazy plan to kill 100,000 jobs across Ontario turned many people, some of his own supporters, against him. But we must never underestimate the role that our union, that our movement played in that election. We not only defeated Tim Hudak, we made sure that his party was in disarray and that he had to resign from politics. My friends, that is one for the history books. Last summer, we also had a strike and a lockout in Ontario, and in their own ways, they were both historic. I don't want to scoop the presentation that is next on the agenda, but just let me say this. Our members in two municipal locals, one very small, one quite large, they both prove that QP Ontario members do not take attacks on our rights and our members lying down. We are a union that doesn't bargain concessions. We fight back and we win. That is what they proved to us last summer. Then in the fall, we had municipal and school board elections, and locals across our province, led by the groundwork in the municipal sector, kept up that theme of making history. In OMEC, our leaders had basically been planning for those elections for 3 full years. Our school board members were more engaged in trustee elections than ever before, and all of that work got real results. We had more QP Ontario members active in their community and school board elections. We had a comprehensive campaign across the province with members in every part of our union, volunteering in campaigns for local candidates, I saw members from the airlines and from healthcare and from social services and universities in campaigns in municipal and school board elections more than I have ever before. And there is no question that the work of our members, the work of our union, was noticed in communities, made a difference. See, since I've had the honor of being a full-time officer in QP Ontario, it's very rare to get a candidate calling me after an election's over. It's pretty common for them to call during an election or before. You know, they always want help and resources. But this time, for the first time, I got dozens of phone calls from municipal and school board candidates thanking me for you, for our members, for our activism in our communities. That has never happened in my time. That is history in our union as well. In October, we held a leadership meeting to talk about the cuts happening in our communities. We didn't divide ourselves by sectors. We instead had breakouts based on where people lived and worked. People heard from each other about the depths of the cuts that are happening in our communities. QP members who lived in the same city or town often had no idea the cuts that were happening in other workplaces. It's because these kind of cuts have become so common, have happened for so many years, we discovered we just stopped talking to each other about them. And so we decided together that we were going to start mobilizing community by community. We decided to mount a campaign to put our members in position, to restart the fight back against austerity at the grassroots level, to build momentum sector by sector, working toward larger provincial action. And that is already starting. There have been meetings and planning in places like Kingston and North Bay, Windsor and Peterborough, Niagara and Sudbury. We're building momentum. Our locals are working together, supporting each other against cuts, supporting each other in difficult bargaining. Look, in Peterborough, as just one example, our locals there, through their QP Council, can marshal 100 people on a day's notice to support one of our locals in difficult bargaining with a bad employer. In fact, they've done it twice in the last few months. And it's not just QP members. They're building connections with other labor unions and other and coalition partners in that community. That is just one example of one community where we are building our strength on the ground, where we are building our members' confidence to fight back. That is key to our fight back of the liberal austerity agenda. And then we've got our school board sector. 55,000 members strong, working in all four school systems. QP members are the heart and soul, the backbone of our schools. And our 55,000 members are now the single largest group of QP members anywhere in Canada in a central bargaining process, bargaining directly with the government. And we have held strike votes in every local, in every unit, with huge attendance at every meeting. And together, our members have given their bargaining committee an unprecedented 93% strike mandate against concessions. And every one of us in this hall must remember that when those workers, whatever action they take, when those workers take action, the rest of our union must be there with them every step of the way. This is history for all of us in QP, my friends. Our university sector had at least two locals in particular that made history this year, not just in Ontario, but across the entire sector. This winter, we had 10,000 QP Ontario members on strike against precarious work and poverty wages. And their efforts sparked a national debate on the state of instruction at universities in Canada. The reality that QP academic members at York and at U of T, who do 60% of the instruction at Canada's two largest universities, make up less than 10% of those universities' budgets. Now, these workers, They stood up, they stood strong, loud, and proud, and they won. Making real gains for our members, not just holding the line, not just negotiating a well-deserved wage increase, but reaching historic agreements that will apply pressure and raise the bar for every other worker in that whole sector. They provided hope for our whole movement. They reminded us of a basic truth. Why do we strike? We strike to win. We made more history in our healthcare sector this year. We had the first ever campaign training of its kind. Close to 80 leaders and activists spent 3 days doing intensive training together to build capacity in our Time to Care campaign. For many years, our members have been fighting for a legislated care standard, 4 hours of care per day per resident in long-term care. And it has been a long fight, with some notice, but there is still no care standard in law. And so our members decided that they needed to reboot, to re-energize, to reimagine all of the ways in which they are going to work to achieve that legislative care standard for seniors in Ontario. And mark my words, there is history to be made here, because no matter how long it takes, we will force the government of Ontario to make the Time to Care the law of the land in this province, my friends. In social services, with so many different kinds of work, we saw a very public battle against the introduction of SAMS, the Social Assistance Management System. Never before have municipal social service workers who administer our social welfare system come together and engaged in so many actions as they did this last year. And that's because these workers have been, even though they've been through so many changes, even though they have to deal with so many regulations, even though there have been many, many different computer systems, this time with SAMS, it was a quantum leap to a new level of messed up. We had more media coverage, more stories in newspapers across Ontario, more activity on the front line, in our workplaces, from our members, on their own behalf, but also on behalf of those that we support who rely on social assistance. And I want to say, on behalf of our members, that when we fix this problem that has been devastating for people who rely on social assistance and disability support and has been damaging for our members, when we succeed in either fixing SAMS or shutting off that system once and for all, we will take that energy and momentum that we have learned and built in this fight, and we will apply it to our efforts to raise social assistance rates, making the draconian cuts of the Mike Harris era history forever. And then this spring came the newest tactic in the Liberals' arsenal of austerity, the historic attempt to sell 60% of our hydro distribution system announced by Kathleen Wynne just 6 short weeks ago. Not that she ever talked about it before, not that she ran on it in the election that happened a year ago. Now, we had to mount a campaign fast to stop the sale of Hydro One. It is a critical fight because the attempt to sell hydro impacts us all. The model of what the Liberals are trying to do here is called asset recycling. And it is a model they want to apply everywhere. Now, I know recycling sounds like something good, right? In this case, it is just another name for privatization. It is just another way to move our collective wealth that we have built up over generations into the hands of a few corporations. It is maddening that the Liberals are using such Orwellian language to describe what they're doing. They won't say they're selling a public asset that we own. They say they're broadening the ownership. Come on, there is no broader ownership than everybody in Ontario owning Hydro One. They also like to say that they are unlocking the value of the asset. Now here's the truth. We put things under lock and key to prevent them from being stolen. The Liberals are trying to swing open the doors and let Bay Street and bankers pillage what we own. And if they can do it with hydro, make no doubt they will move on to schools and hospitals and bridges and whatever else they think they can sell. Hydro One transmits and distributes electricity across the province. It's all the towers and wires that you see across Ontario. And they are there Because our grandparents and great-grandparents bought and paid for them with their taxes, they belong to us. And the liberals are saying they want to sell 60% of it, 60% of it to investors. And they claim that by having 40%, the government will keep a majority. Now, I don't know about you, but 40% has never been a majority where I come from. Here's what they're not telling Ontarians. They are actually planning for a time when the government will own less than 10% of Hydro One. That is what is in their omnibus piece of legislation, Bill 91, which enables the sale of Hydro. We have seen these kind of monster omnibus bills before. They're usually, you know, the Tories that do it, the Harpers and the Hudaks and the Harrises of the world, but this time it is the Liberals, and they're borrowing more than a few pages from Mike Harris's playbook, because it was Mike Harris in 2001 who announced their intention to sell what was then called Ontario Hydro. And that included, at the time, transmission and distribution and generation. And at the time, the Ontario Electricity Coalition took the lead, and Keepy was a major player in that coalition. And we must, in fact, be very proud of members from Keepy Local 1, the workers at Toronto Hydro, in particular, Brother Paul Carnart and Sister Charlene Mueller, who were the driving forces in the Ontario Electricity Coalition. That coalition built resistance, community by community, against the sale of Ontario Hydro, so much so that polls at the time said 94% of Ontarians, virtually everybody, was against that sale. And at the same time, our union, working with the CEP, now part of Unifor, began a court challenge against the sale because we believed the law prevented the Tories from actually selling it. And in 2002, the court agreed with us and they stopped the sale based on the wording in the law. Now, since the Tories couldn't sell Hydro based on the wording in the law, they rewrote it. But they didn't dare move to sell Hydro because of the resistance that we had built on the ground, because of the massive public opposition to it. And so they broke Ontario Hydro into pieces. Hydro One, which is transmission and distribution, and hydro power generation. And they contented themselves with selling the Bruce nuclear plant, which is a major source of power generation. But then an election came, and the Liberals of the day, under this leader of theirs named Dalton McGuinty, campaigned on keeping Hydro public. And they won, and they lied, because they steadily set about ensuring that all new generation would be built and owned and operated by the private sector, sometimes multinational corporations. Virtually all the new gas-fired power plants, for example, in Ontario are built and owned and operated by the private sector. It's why the gas plant scandal that you've heard about, why did it cost us $1 billion? It's not just the cancellation of the buildings. It's because the contracts that our government signed with these multinational corporations said that if there was a cancellation, we had to pay them the amount anticipated in profit for the next 20 years. That's why it's costing us so much money. That movement to private generation of electricity is why Ontarians pay some of the highest hydro rates in the country. It's why hydro rates have gone up over 300% since Mike Harris started us down this path of privatization. And that is just with a part of our generation system privatized. Now let's be clear what selling any part of Hydro One would mean. Because just like in generation, private investors will want profit. And the easiest way to make profit, I mean, the towers and wires are already there. The easiest way to make profit is to put up the cost of our hydro. And it has happened everywhere where the private sector has been involved in electricity. We know better than to believe the Liberals when they say that rates will be controlled by the Ontario Energy Board, because rates have gone up 320% in the last 15 years under the Ontario Energy Board. That's the same group that's supposed to keep rates down. I mean, come on. We will lose control of this vital lever of our economy. It's why some businesses are now, in fact, saying They want to keep hydro public because they understand having to pay increased costs for hydro will eat into their profits. And let's be clear about what this means for all of us in this room. What it means for the broader public sector. We know what austerity budgets have meant in hospitals and schools and social services and universities, with our funding being frozen or even worse, being cut. Now, I want you to imagine for one moment what will happen when the school board has to pay two or three times what they're paying for hydro. What will happen in the hospital and the long-term care facility when the cost of keeping on the lights or heating the facility, never mind running all the equipment, skyrockets. I want you to think of the thousands of group homes for kids, shelters for the homeless, developmental services, childcare centers. What will it mean for universities with all their buildings and labs and classrooms? What will it mean in airlines with Toronto being such a huge hub for all of our airlines? What about the running of the very streetcars that are on the road outside of this hotel? We know where employers will turn to deal with their increased costs of hydro. They will come to us. In schools, they're not going to go to teachers. They're going to come and try to contract out custodial and maintenance work, office and clerical work, get rid of more EAs. My God, we're already seeing that today. It will mean more hours of care cut in developmental services and long-term care, fewer childcare spaces and childcare centers closing, more hospital beds cut, more members losing their jobs in the healthcare sector, massive cuts in universities, and a bigger hill to climb in our fight for fairness for precarious work of academic workers in those institutions. And all of this will be compounded by the fact that the provincial government actually gets money, almost $1 billion a year, from Ontario Hydro. They want to give away that yearly revenue, putting even more strain on government resources to fund public services, which is why, with all of the struggles our union is facing, from this liberal austerity agenda, I'm spending so much time talking about this fight against the sale of Hydro One because this wrong-headed decision will be visited on each and every one of our bargaining tables. It will be visited on each and every one of our members in their hydro bills at home. It is why we must make sure that we have to understand that it's not just about cost. Hydro is also an important symbolic public asset. The Liberals are also huge. There have been huge proponents of privatization. The Auditor General just said they overspent over $8 billion because of their obsession with public-private partnerships. But trust me, if they think they can get away with selling our hydro system without a real and mounting and sustained amount of political pain, the floodgates will just open. That is why we have dedicated so much time and energy and money to this fight in recent weeks. It is why we must impress upon all parts of our union the fundamental importance of the fight to keep hydro public. It's why in just a few short weeks we have brought together the Keep Hydro Public Coalition. It has more unions and more community groups involved in this fight than ever before. It's why the Ontario NDP has been hammering the Liberals in the legislature, in the press, in communities. It's why they engaged in direct action. My God, Andrea Horvath and most of the caucus got kicked out of the legislature on the day that they announced the sale. Good on them, I say. It's why we rearranged the agenda of our convention. It's why we are having our rally on Thursday at noon. On Thursday, the process known as clause-by-clause debate on Bill 91 will begin. It's the time when amendments to the law can be made, and we need to be out on the lawns of Queen's Park, joined by others in a show of solidarity against the Liberals' plans to sell hydro, because any politician of any political stripe who thinks they can get away with implementing this kind of austerity, selling a vital public asset like hydro, without hearing the complaints from the people, will simply be emboldened to do more. And my friends, no matter what happens with that piece of legislation, because there is a majority government, and it is likely it will pass, perhaps unaltered. But if that happens, we need to be loud and clear. It will not stop our campaign to stop the sale of what we own. We will dog every investor. We will find every possible wrench to throw into their sale. We will fight them all the way to the next election if we have to keep hydro public. Is solidarity against austerity, my friends. And there are other real examples of hope, because the fight back against austerity is a global fight, and it is why we have such an honor to be joined by Lucia McKeever, the national president of the largest public sector union in the UK, Unison. She's going to share with us the work that they are doing to fight back against austerity across the pond, as they like to say. And can I just say one more word that shows some hope in the fight against austerity? Alberta. I mean, come on. If the NDP can be elected to a majority government after 40 years of conservative rule with a massive majority running on an unadulterated and unapologetic progressive platform to raise the minimum wage and raise corporate taxes and roll back cuts in schools and education, then my friends, anything is possible. And we are also going to be joined at this convention by the man who, with our help and support, could quite possibly be the very next Prime Minister of our country, Tom Mulcair. Now look, the federal election that is coming this fall is so central to our country's future, so important to our children and their children. It is all about making history. More and more people are coming to see that we must stop the damage that Stephen Harper and the Conservatives are doing, their attempts to reshape the very nature of our country. We have to reclaim our place and our reputation in the world, but we gotta bring our members to see that we must do that too. My friends, it is not good enough to just heave Steve. We learned from our last provincial election, it is way too dangerous and too simple to only focus on voting against something. We got to be able to encourage our members to vote for something. And there is so much on offer here. We are one election away from a national childcare program, one election away from a quantum leap in retirement security by enhancing the CPP, one election away from corporations actually starting to pay their fair share in corporate taxes, one election away from the absolute repeal of the draconian and dangerous Bill C-51, one election away from the full reinstatement of door-to-door mail delivery. My God, the list goes on and on, but make no mistake. Every one of us in this room, every one of us in this room has to understand we have a job to do if we want to make that kind of history. This fall, we have to apply the same energy and commitment and activity that we applied in the municipal and provincial elections last year. We have got to get our members out to vote, because every vote matters. We got to be part of the tidal wave that is going to sweep across the country and bring us the first NDP government in Canada's history. So are you in? Will you help make history in October? Will you help elect Tom Mulcair, the Prime Minister of Canada? Will you help? Will you volunteer? That's good, because I'm going to hold you to that, because I travel around a lot, eh? My friends, we are fighting back and we are winning. We are making a difference. We are making history. I need to sincerely thank all of you, the local leaders and activists that are in this room. I know the vast majority of you do double duty. You work for the employer and you volunteer for our union. But I want you to know, please know, your passion and your strength make a difference. I need to say a sincere thank you to our national staff. They are the very best in the labor movement. Each and every one of our national staff is an essential part of our collective success. Please know that your skill and commitment make a difference. And I really need to say thank you to our provincial executive board, in particular my co-officer, Sister Candace Rennick, the amazing staff that we have in Kiepe, Ontario. We are a small but mighty team. There is much to do and very few of us to do it. But please know that your dedication to our members, to our union, to the services our members provide, it's amazing. It makes me proud to be in Kiepe. Yeah, I didn't think I was going to be able to get through without a little tears. There you go. Okay. Together, my friends, we're making history. And one day, people are going to look back at the days we are living in, and they are going to say, that is the time when the tides started to turn against austerity. That is the time when people came together and started to make a real difference in Ontario and across Canada and around the world. We are living in history, my friends, and I can't think of a better group of people, a better union, a better movement to make history. Have a wonderful convention, my friends. Okay, now they're teasing me for crying. Okay. Now I should introduce to you our executive board, the amazing group that I just talked to you about. You know, of course, that my name's Fred, I'm the president, and you've met Candace, she's the secretary treasurer. Michael Hurley is the first vice president, he's from Ochu. Yolanda McLean is the second vice president, she's a member of Kiepe Local 4400 in Toronto. John Camilleri is the third vice president, a member of Local 1 in Toronto. Henri Giroux is a member of Local 146. He is the fourth vice president from North Bay. Joanne Webb is a member of Local 7800. She is the diversity vice president representing Aboriginal workers. She's from Hamilton. Patrick Hannon is from Local 543. He's the diversity vice president for LGBTQ workers, and he is from Windsor. Verilyn Howe is from Local 2191. She is the diversity vice president representing racialized workers. She's from Toronto. Vern Anders is from Local 5555. He is a general board member and a school board worker from Cobourg. Tiffany Balducci is from Local 960. She is a board member from Durham and a proud librarian. Dan Crow is from Local 4207, a board member from Niagara from the university sector. Helen Federley is a board member from Cornwall, also from Ochu. That's right, yeah, okay, sorry. Tracy Newman is from Local 5200. She's a board member from Halton Region and the school boards. Eddie Pereira is from Local 2544. He's a board member from Peel and the school boards. Misty Gagne is the chair of the municipal sector. She's from Local 241 in Guelph. Janice Folk-Dawson is the chair of the university sector. She's from Local 1334 in Guelph. Carrie Lynn Pilcottenham is the chair of the social services sector. She's from Local 503 in Ottawa. Kelly O'Sullivan is the chair of the healthcare workers sector. She's from Local 4308 in Toronto. And Terry Preston is the chair of the school board workers from Local 4400 in Toronto. And we are also proud to have Bill Hartford, who represents retirees, on our executive board. My friends, your executive board in Kiepe, Ontario. And we have also been joined by a regional vice president of the National Union, the president of the Healthcare Employees Union, part of Kiepe in British Columbia. Brother Victor Elkins has joined us. Welcome, Victor. Okay. Now we get to move on to the recognition of striking locals. Now, delegates, this part of the convention I particularly look forward to. It's when we recognize locals and members who have been on strike or locked out in the previous year. We have had four locals that have been on the picket line. Starting on Monday of this week, a fifth, Kiepe Local 101, representing inside workers in the City of London, has been forced on strike against concessions. But before I introduce you to these workers, I just want to say a few words about the right to strike. In more than 98% of cases, QP, we bargain successfully our collective agreements without any kind of work stoppage. But make no mistake, the right to strike when and if we need to is at the core of the power that we have as organized workers. And even in those sectors where the right to, where the strike option has been replaced by contract arbitration, even there, our legally assured access to fair and binding and neutral arbitration only exists because of our, it's an alternative to the strike weapon. Everyone in this hall knows that the right to strike has come under attack in recent years, both at the federal and provincial level. Stephen Harper used his power to deny the right to strike to our members who work in the airlines and to postal workers before their strike even started. In Ontario in 2011, Dalton McGuinty passed Bill 150, removing the legal right to strike from 10,000 workers, including QP members of Local 2 at the Toronto Transit Commission. The same Liberal government brought in Bill 115, which in 2012 denied the right to strike to some 200,000 school board workers, including 55,000 QP members. And nothing has changed since we got a new Liberal leader, because just this week, the Wynne government has tabled back-to-work legislation denying the right to strike to our sisters and brothers in the Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation. But alongside these threats to the right to strike have been some very good news indeed. Earlier this year, in a historic and unprecedented decision, the Supreme Court of Canada reversed all previous decisions and ruled that the right to strike is protected by the freedom of association as set out in Section 2 of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. The right to strike is guaranteed as a fundamental right under the very Constitution of our country, and we need to be proud as QP members in understanding that it was our union, working along with others, to produce this ruling because they were fighting against a law that the government in Saskatchewan had tried to bring in, basically saying all public sector strikes would be illegal. This is so significant, so important. I just want to quote to you from the court decision. This is the majority decision by Madam Justice Rosalie Albera, and she wrote the following. The right to strike is an essential part of meaningful collective bargaining in our system of labor relations. Through a strike, workers come together to participate directly in the process of determining their wages, working conditions, and the rules that will govern their working lives. The ability to strike thereby allows workers, through collective action, to refuse work under imposed terms and conditions. This collective action, at the moment of impasse, is an affirmation of the dignity and autonomy of employees in their working lives. Boy, oh boy, has it been a long time since we wanted the highest court in the land to write words like that. With all that said, it is now my distinct honor and pleasure to recognize QP locals that have been locked out or on strike over the past year. Local 1490, Black River Matheson, Local 1764, Durham Region, Local 3902 at the University of Toronto, Local 3903 at York University, and Local 101, the City of London. Now, I'm hoping representatives from those locals, they're all standing over there. Okay, perfect. All right. We're going to do one at a time. Let's start with Local 1490. QP Local 1490 represents 17 full-time employees and 5 summer students in the community of Black River Matheson. Oh, sorry, this local isn't with us today. But let me tell you a little bit about them. There's only 17 of them, eh? This is a small local. On the morning of Monday, August the 11th, the mayor and council in Black River Matheson locked these workers out 1 hour before they were supposed to go to work. The employer wanted to change their shifts of 8 public works employees so that the 4 junior members of the department would never, ever have a weekend off with their families, ever. Local 1490 is small. They're not yet affiliated to other parts of the movement. They have very few resources. But with our donations and our picket line support, we brought solidarity actions to them, and after being locked out for nearly 2 months, the members ratified an agreement, and they had the right to force the township council to do the same. They tried to refuse to ratify the agreement that had no concessions in it, and we forced them to do it. Local 1490 isn't only a local force, but they're very much connected to the rest of us, and we hope one day we will be able to have them as an affiliate of Keepie Ontario. Keepie Local 1764. In June, Durham Region's 15,000 municipal workers went on strike after Durham Region pushed for concessions targeting the region's emergency medical services workers. Management and council only targeted EMS workers' sick leave plan. Now, we know that EMS workers, because of the nature of their work, are exposed to all kinds of health situations that might put them at a higher risk of having to use more sick time. At the heart of this dispute was the employer's attempt to try and target EMS workers' sick leave benefits. Management wanted to penalize these workers, and they were hoping to divide and conquer. Imagine how ironic the Durham Region wanted to punish EMS workers who get sick when it's these same workers every day who help the sick and the injured and residents in emergency situations. What was really remarkable in this situation, my friends, is that it didn't work in terms of its being divided and conquered. You see, the concessions were only against the paramedics. Every other member of the bargaining unit was offered an agreement without concessions and a wage increase. But because of the strong leadership of the bargaining committee and the staff assigned, they brought forward to the entire membership the need to stand up and defend this relatively small number of workers, because an injury to one is an injury to all. Now, I won't sugarcoat it. It was a difficult strike. But in the end, our members stayed together, and the employer did not get the sick leave concessions that they wanted. I want to present to you representatives of Local 1764. I'm happy to present them with a plaque. And please help me to welcome President Neil Henderson to speak to us. Unlike every other person in the hall, he doesn't want to say anything. So there you go. I'm only kidding. Okay, let's move on. 3902, Unit 1, went on strike against the University of Toronto on February 27th, 2015. The reason for the strike? Well, as the union chair Aaron Black put it, we're poor, precarious, and we need improvement to our living standards. So very true. The almost 6,000 members of QP 3902 Unit 1, the majority of whom are teaching assistants, but also demonstrators, markers, invigilators, oh, I don't even know what that is, teaching lab assistants, have all had their funding frozen for their wages since 2008. In fact, TAs at U of T, Canada's largest university, were on average taking home $15,000 a year. The local used the strike to bring attention to the growing reliance on low-paid, precarious academic workers on campus. Our members said on the line, "We lecture, we teach, a living wage should be in reach."
We lecture.
We teach, a living wage should be in reach. Oh God, I love that chant. Okay. Support grew for striking teaching assistants after a month on the picket line in epic cold weather with the most awesome hype squad I have ever seen, ever. The members ratified an agreement and sent outstanding issues to binding arbitration. The agreement increases the minimum funding that local members receive. There is a guaranteed tuition relief for unfunded PhDs and master's students. There's benefit improvements. Our members at U of T went on strike. They went on strike to win, and that is exactly what they did. I am very proud to present to you representatives of QP 3902, Evan Mill, who is the external unit chair, Ryan Culpepper, who is the chair of Local 3902, and Aaron Black, who is the past chair and was the chair during the strike.
Hey there, and all of you, and all of you.
Why do we
do better than that. Why do we strike?
Strike to win.
Why do we strike?
Strike to win.
Why do we strike?
Strike to win.
I can't hear you over there. Why do we strike?
Strike to win.
Why do we strike?
Strike to win.
Why do we strike?
Strike to win.
I want to hug each and every one of you, but we're already behind the main agenda.
Thank you.
Local 3903 at York University. On Monday, March the 2nd, 3,700 teaching assistants, graduate students, and contract faculty at York University who are members of Local 3903 walked off the job. Members at York were clear. They wanted a fair and equitable collective agreement. They wanted new international student members who should have had their tuition frozen back to 2002 like all other members, refunded the $7,000 hike in tuition that York had imposed on them. They wanted increased job security for contract faculty. They wanted employment equity language that included LGBTQ workers as part of designated groups for employment equity. And you know what? After a month on strike, 3903 members got exactly that. They refused to settle for anything less. They ratified a historic collective agreement which contains broad improvements to pay and working conditions. It is a historic agreement, one that I have no doubt will take the fight to ensure that others live up to the bar that York has set. It is truly historic. I want to present to you representatives of Local 3903. Jen Seifer, the chairperson of Local 3903.
Hi, I just wanted to thank you all for your support and solidarity during our strike. And I wanted to put a special shout out to Steelworkers Local 9176, who you are supposed to be going to visit on Friday. Those are the people that have been on strike at Crown Cans for the last over a year, almost 2 years now. And they came out to our picket lines almost every week, sometimes twice a week, to show us solidarity and share tips on how to dress for a picket line in the winter. So I would appreciate it if you folks could go out and support them. We still have members that are going out to support them. And I just want to say one more time, why do we strike? We strike to win! Thank you very much.
If I start hugging, we're going to be even further behind. Now, I just want to wrap up by speaking about QP Local 101 in the City of London. QP Local 101 is an inside municipal local. We are proud to represent 750 workers there. They have a long bargaining relationship with that city. There has not been a dispute of any kind in collective bargaining for more than 36 years. However, in the last municipal elections, we elected a new mayor and council in London. And the Labour-endorsed mayor and several Labour-endorsed councillors were in fact elected. Well, that's a good news story, eh? Well, the management team in London have been trying to bargain severe concessions for our members. These are principles of a collective agreement that have been there for 30, 40, 50 years, things that every other employee of the City of London represented in other collective agreements enjoys, and yet somehow the City of London thinks that our members in Keepy Local 101 are going to bend and take concessions. And my friends, they're so wrong. Because our members in that local, even though most of the people in that local will never have been on strike in their lives, voted well over 90% to stand strong against concessions, and they began strike action on Monday morning with 750 of them at City Hall, marching proudly. The president of the local, Shelley, is doing an amazing job. You know, she was besieged by every media outlet in that city. She was asked the kind of questions that people ask us when we go on strike, the things that try to divert us from our own message, that try to make us look like somehow we're doing something that hurts other people. She was clear and strong and consistent in her answers. The people of London, the city of London, work because our members work. They love their jobs. They live in that community. They raise their families there. And by God, they deserve to be treated with respect by their employer. We don't have a plaque for them, but I want to hand it over to the local to talk to you a little bit about their situation. And I want you to please welcome and congratulate for their courage in standing against concessions, members of Local 101, City of London employees.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Wow, I never, after my 28 years with CUPE, I never thought I'd be up here addressing the convention. I'm usually out there supporting everybody that comes up here, but now I find myself on this stage coming to you to bring you information on what's happening in the City of London with the inside workers and asking for your support. So just a little bit of background, CUPE Local 101 turned 71 years old this year. Our last strike was 36 years ago in 1979. I think that says a lot. Notice to bargain was served on the employer in October with an expression to start bargaining before the collective agreement expired in the hopes of getting a collective agreement before it expired. What a novelty that was. They told us that they couldn't bargain because there was a new council coming in and they had to wait to get direction. So we didn't start bargaining until January 7th. When we arrived on January the 7th for a proposal exchange, the employer was not ready. They were still in their room preparing their proposals, printing them off at the hotel office before they walked in. When they eventually walked in and handed us their package, we looked at it. We caucused for about 10 minutes, advised the employer we were immediately applying for conciliation. We might as well rip up our collective agreement because that's exactly what they were after, everything in our collective agreement. Being the local that we are, being the bigger person than the employer, we decided that we would meet with them without the conciliator in an effort to see what we could do with these concessions. Each time we met, they were never ready. They would leave us waiting sometimes for up to an hour and a half after the agreed upon time of starting for bargaining. They showed us no respect for our bargaining team and for our members. So, starting last week, we all started wearing our respect buttons in the workplace. That didn't work, but let me tell you about some of the proposals that are still before us. So they want to expand our work week, our work hours actually. So currently we have Monday to Friday, 8:30 to 4:30. There are some exceptions. There are some areas of our bargaining unit whose work doesn't fit within 8:30 to 4:30. So over the years, we have bargained hours of work, shift premium for those individuals. What they put before us, well, actually what they put before us was just one statement, expand core hours. I don't know what that meant. There was no wording, there was no language. Many of their proposals were like that, just a blanket statement that they wanted to change or delete something. So with the hours of work, they want us now to work Monday to Sunday, 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. They want to be able to schedule us anywhere in that time period with no notice. So essentially, you know, getting away from the Saturday-Sunday weekend that unions bargained so hard to achieve. One of their other concessions was job evaluation. At first they said, no more joint job evaluation, we'll take care of it. Oh, well then they softened their position. They said, all right, we'll keep the joint job evaluation process, But if there's an impasse on any of the factors, we'll have the Director of Human Resources make the deciding factor with no grievance or arbitration process. So we might as well get rid of JE. Next are early retiree benefits. They want to take away early retiree benefits for all new workers, so essentially targeting young and new workers coming into the workforce. We're not having anything to do with a two-tier system. We have... Our members are standing strong on that point because, unfortunately, we have a bit of a two-tier in our collective agreement from many, many, many years ago on our sick leave program. So I think we only have 13 left in the membership who enjoy a payout, a sick leave payout upon retirement, and a different calculation for accruing. So the majority of the members don't have that benefit and privilege and haven't had that since 1985. So those of us who don't have that know what it feels like to be in a bargaining unit that doesn't enjoy the same benefit as everybody in the bargaining unit. So we're pretty strong on the fact that there will be no more two-tier in our collective agreement. Next, they want to attack our job posting language. So currently we have the threshold clause. Seniority is the governing factor. If you're qualified, the senior person gets the job. Now they want to look at it that seniority's there. They might look at seniority. They might look at qualifications. They might look at experience. But certainly seniority is not going to be a governing factor. And in fact, I would dare to say that seniority will have no weight at all. So that is definitely something we're not interested in. They want to attack our benefits. They want a clawback on what we currently have. So we currently have a current ODA. They want to go with a one-year lag. They want to take away with prescription drugs that it must be mandatory that they're generic. If your doctor is indicating you must have the prescribed drug, we'd have to pay the difference. We had a member come to a meeting and say that she did the calculation on just one of four of her family members who does require medication, and she actually did the calculation of what that difference would be between the generic and the actual drug, and for that family member it was going to cost her over $500, so money out of our members' pockets, so they're not standing for that either. We heard both Sid and Fred talk about what generations before us have done to achieve the collective agreements and the benefits that we all enjoy within our locals and as a union as a whole. And that's very much at the core of what's happening here at the City of London. They are trying to claw back things that we have negotiated for decades. And for some reason in the City of London, they seem to be targeting our local, the Inside Works local. They're not targeting any other employee group with such draconious benefit clawbacks and just clawbacks in general. On day one of our strike, which as Fred mentioned was Monday, we were all at City Hall together, and on the drop of a hat we were able to pull together a rally, although we weren't supposed to call it that, but we call it a rally.
That's right.
And Fred came down, of course, to bring greetings. But before I talk about Fred and his message, we were able to have some other special guest speakers. And for those who may not be familiar with the politics in London, our new council consists of a mayor who is a teacher and an OSSTF member. We have half of the council who are Labour-friendly NDPers, and our Labour council endorsed and supported the mayor and those council members. None of them seem to be supporting us. If they were, they wouldn't have us out on the street. They've forced us to go out. I don't understand. So at our rally, we had a representative from OSSTF come to bring us greetings and have a couple little jabs at Mayor Matt Brown. We also had members from OPSU Unifor, ETFO, and of course our Labor Council. And what really bolstered up our members that day, of course, was Fred. Bar none, he is our union heart and soul. And after the rally, members who really don't understand how we operate as labor and how we support each other in solidarity walked away and just went, wow, really? That's how it is? So they're quite pumped and happy for the support. QP Local 107, our outside works folks, have been very supportive for us through this process. We are picketing two of our works yards where, although we have some Local 101 members that work there, it's primarily Local 107 members. And the brothers and sisters there have shown us tremendous support on our picket lines by honoring our picket lines and waiting very, very patiently, sometimes for up to 2 hours, quite happily, to honor our picket lines. So to them, I thank you very much. Of course, we couldn't make it this far through this process without the assistance and guidance of our national representative, Fred Blake. He's been fabulous. QP Ontario Division and the National Union. You know, as I said, I'm usually out there listening to all of this and how people come and say how they've been supported, but you truly don't really understand it until you're going through it. Just exactly what that support means. Thank you for that. I also just want to say that commenting on the message and the words that Brigida brought us from this morning, with solidarity, we stand strong.
The full weight and support of our 250,000 members in Ontario will be behind this local, and we're going to be asking you now to make a donation. We're going to take a floor collection for them. So we're asking the staff if you could organize that, please. We're asking you delegates, please, to be generous. We need a strong show of support here for this local and to this employer. On microphone one, Fred.
Fred Hahn from QP Ontario. Candace asked me to come to a microphone on behalf of QP Ontario and start the ball rolling with an initial donation of $5,000 to Local 101.
Microphone one, Brian.
I see Fred's last name as Horn.
Name and local, brother, please.
QP Local 122, North Bay. Our standard maximum $250 for QP Local 101. We stand in support with our brothers and sisters. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Paul Clululo, QP Local 241, City of Guelph. Our local would like to donate $2,000 to the London local. Thank you very much.
Microphone three.
Ryan Culpepper, QP Local 3902. To our brothers and sisters on strike as we were in Local 101, we're proud to donate $1,000. We can't wait to see you on your picket lines. Strike to win.
Microphone one.
Tracy Newman, QP Ontario, executive member at large and facilitating partner with Shelley. I see Brother Charles Fleury in the room. Brother Charles, I would challenge National to match any monies collected on the floor today.
Microphone two.
Christine Shannon, on behalf of Local One, we'd like to donate $500.
Thank you. Microphone four.
Linda Bolton, President, Local 126, City of Peterborough Inside Workers. And we'd like to donate $500 and stay strong, brothers and sisters.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Vandervoort 543 Windsor. We'd like to donate maximum that we can on the floor, $500.
Thank
you. Stay strong, guys.
Microphone one.
Drew Faulkner, Vice President, Local 1764, Durham Inside Workers, $200 based on our bylaws.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Jeff Ann White, President, QP 181. As per our bylaws, we'd like to donate $400.
Thank you. Microphone four.
Lisa Webbuffer, Local 973, first speaker. On behalf of my local, I'd like to donate $100.
Good job, Lisa. Microphone three.
Hi, Audrey Tam, President, 4044 Canjot Flight Attendants. We're down to 35 members, but we'd be happy to donate $200 to Local 101.
Thank you. Microphone one.
In Sandra Walker, President of QP Local 5167, City of Hamilton. After having fought off what reads like an identical list of concessions, anything you need, Shelley, let us know, okay? And we brought a donation as well.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Peck, Treasurer 229, we'd like to donate $500.
Thank you, brother. Microphone four.
Local 1833, $250.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Hi, TJ Zanelli, Local 4914. We'd like to donate $250.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Hi, Fred Watt, President, Local 905. Under our bylaws, the maximum amount, we'll donate $250. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Hi, Claudette Morrow from Local 4365, Treasurer. Our local would like to donate $200.
Thank you. Microphone four.
From QP 45114, $500.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Hi, I'm Lisa May from QP Local 2026. As per our bylaws, we'd like to donate $100.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Tiffany Balducci, QP 960, $100 as per our bylaws, solidarity, and we'll be back with more. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Éric Thériault de la section locale 5335. On va donner le
5334 the maximum that according the bylaws $250. Thank you very much.
John Cloutier, Local 3045, Municipality of Greenstone. We donate $200.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Colleen Ferreira, Local 1356, York University. $100 as per bylaws.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Rodney McGee, Local 2486, Lakewood District School Board, $250.
Thank you, brother. Microphone two.
Elena DiNardo, QP Local 2331, as per our bylaws, $200.
Thank you. Microphone four.
Alistair Bruff, QP Local 107, London, Ontario, as part of our bylaws, we'll donate $4,000.
Thank you, brother. Microphone three, Tim.
Tim McGuire, QP Local 79. We were on strike for 6 weeks in 2009 and appreciated the solidarity from our sisters and brothers in QP and beyond. We had our most difficult round of negotiations in our history with Rob Ford, his administration. We understand completely what it means to have an administration refusing to bargain with you. We gave Local 4302 and 3903 each $5,000 today, or will be giving today. We pledge $500 and take a recommendation for a further $4,500 for a total of $5,000 for QP 101. Happy birthday.
Thank you, Jim. Microphone one.
Jen Cypher, QP 3903, York University. Thanks, Tim, for the $5,000. As per our bylaws, we've donated $100 to the folks in London, and I'll bring it to our GMM to see if we can get more. Strike to win, you guys.
Microphone two.
Stefan Konstantopoulos, Local 4228. We're donating $200.
Thank you. Microphone four.
Kim Crapper, Local 150.
We're going to donate $200 as per our bylaws.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Decatur Local 5678 Upper Canada District School Board. We would like to donate $500.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Michelle Lemieux, President 1310, on behalf of my members, $1,000.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Diane Pecor, QP 7811. I have a check for $100.
Thank you, Diane. Microphone four.
Brad Benson, Local 4705 from Sudbury. We'd like to donate $250.
Thank you, brother. Microphone three.
James McPherson, QP Local 129. We'd like to donate $250 to the cause, and we'll take it back to the membership to try to get more.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Julia Lynch, City of Kingston, Local 109, as per our bylaws, $750.
Thank you.
Solidarity.
Microphone two.
Mike Felici, QP 5071, $300 as per our bylaws.
Thank you. Microphone four.
Don Poster, QP 5555, Kawartha Pine Ridge District School Board. As our per the bylaws, $200. And Shelley, I will be on your picket line. Tell the brothers and sisters that.
Thank you, Don. Microphone three.
Sue Lukowitz, Local 4153, and we'll be donating $500.
Thank you. Microphone one, Frank.
Frank Petresca, QP Local 4156. As to our bylaws, we're donating $200.
Thank you. Microphone two.
I'm Heather Henry, QP 4616 from Bonfield, $100.
Microphone four, Dave.
Dave Smith, Local 4400, Toronto Education Workers. Just before I donate for our local, I thought I might mention, since we're online, it might be a chance for people watching to also donate. But Local 4400 would like to donate $5,000.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Hi, Jim Sacchetti, QP 1750. We'd like to donate $200.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Microphone one, Patricia.
Patricia Pitt, Local 3808. On behalf of our local, I would like to donate $100 according to our bylaw. And I would encourage Local 101 to be strong. Don't give up. A quitter does not achieve the goal. Thank you.
Microphone two.
Diane Directeur, Local
4155, donation of, according to our bylaws, $100. Thank you very much.
Chad Goble, Local 82, City of Windsor Outside Workers, $100 as per our bylaws, and we'll bring it back to the members for more.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Ian Nash, President 2974, on behalf of our members, we'd like to donate $250.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Local 2289, St. Stephen's, donating $100.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Sarah Chibber, Local 1281, $250 as per our bylaws.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Hello, Nick Ruloff, K. Ruga from QP 4207, Brock University. Our members would be happy to donate $500.
Thank you.
So from Local 4207, my name's Lauren, and as a young worker who's affected by these political conditions, a precarious worker, I just want to say thanks, a big shout out for not selling us out, the young workers. Stay strong, folks.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Karen Maloney, president of Local 2577, donating $200 from our members. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Yeah, Chris Cobley from 7548 in Kingston CAS workers and Napanee CAS workers, $250, and I'm going to take back a proposal for $750 more from the membership.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Hi, good morning. Mary Lomengawil from Local 1404. As per bylaw, $200 will go to the local.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Linda Lisisco, Local 3732. We'd like to donate $250.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Leanne Evans, Local 1022, as per our bylaws, will donate $200.
Thank you. Microphone one.
$500 and back to our membership for more. Thank you.
Thank you. Three.
Five.
You can turn it up, eh? You can, yeah.
Colin McDougall, QP 1165, $250, and we'll bring back to our local.
Thank you. One.
Susie Vienna, Azevedo, Local 5200, Halton Catholic District School Board, EAs and ECs, as per our bylaws, we can donate $100.
Thank you. Microphone four. Three.
Dan Bouchard, QP Local 2544, as per our bylaws, we'd like to donate $100 and we'll take it back to the membership for more.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Christine Bartnick, QP 3396, as per our bylaws, will donate $100, and I will personally give you my days per diem, which is another $100, and we will see you on the picket line, and we will go back to our members until this is solved to make sure you have what you need.
Microphone two.
QP Local 3904, Ryerson University. We're donating $250 from our members. Thank you.
Thank you. Three.
Local 2501. Hi, Phil. Hi, Shelley. I know you guys. $250 as per our bylaws, and we'll take it back for more. Thank you.
Thank you. Mike, one.
Sandra Forsythe, Local 2936, and as per our bylaws, I'll donate $100 and we'll take it back to the membership for more. And stay strong.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Kathy Lee, retired worker. I would like to personal donate $100.
Thank you. Thank you. Microphone one.
Andrew Rhodes, Local 4685, Sault Ste. Marie. Our bylaws allow for 100.
Thank you. Three.
Dan Millett, Local 4720, representing social services workers in North Bay and area. 250 as per our bylaws.
Thank you. One.
Kathy Carpino, QP Local 57, Guelph General Hospital. As per our bylaws, $75, and we'll take it back to our membership.
Thank you. Four.
Jose DeWart, QP Local 1328. As per our bylaws, we'll donate $200.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Hey, Kyle Gemmel, Local 1019, Niagara Dispatchers Paramedics. We got $300 as per our bylaws. We'll try for more. Strike to win, strike to cut butt.
Thank you. David, microphone one. One? Sorry, not David. I'm sorry.
Albert Joseph, Local 2191.
Sorry, Albert.
That's okay, Brother Michael. Community Living Toronto, Local 2191. We are pleased to support the local with $100 as per our bylaws and take it back to our members for a more considerable amount.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Bonnie Kitchen, Local 3987. As per bylaws, $100.
Thank you, sister. Brothers and sisters, Paul Moyse, National President. Two announcements. Brother Charles, let me do this time. We're proudly going to double every nickel that's been raised on the floor here today. Number one. And second announcement, as much as I would love to hear Tom Mulcair Friday at noon, I'm going to London. We're going to have a rally at City Hall on Friday at 11 o'clock to announce this generosity.
Okay, sisters and brothers, our staff have been doing a quick count, but I can report to you we're going to get you an official number right after lunch, including the floor collection, but I can tell you that this is well in excess of $40,000, $80,000 when matched by the National Union. And this is the solidarity that we have when we stand together.